Well, hello, friends. Glad you could make it. I want to offer a hello to Ashlyn, as I know she has somewhat patiently been waiting for me to post this video. I am certain that she is the first person to view this. Hello, Ashlyn. Today, we have a lot of ground to cover. We will get from the isolationist sentiment that prevented the United States from signing the Treaty of Versailles and joining the League of Nations at the end of the First World War, to the United States' emergence as one of two superpowers at the end of the Second World War. Before I start, I want to point out that if we were meeting face-to-face, this material would take me 3 or 4 class periods to get through. In class, I would show great clips from Ken Burns' superb documentary, The War. My coverage will not be comprehensive, and my focus will be more on the social impacts of the war. If I skip your favorite battle, I apologize. If it feels like I am going through this information quickly, I am. It's Chapter 26, The Second World War. I am not going to spend too much time on the 1920s, but it is worth at least quickly mentioning some of the ideas and events that were influential, some of which you read about in Chapter 25. President Wilson's plan to make the world safe for democracy failed as a result of the disillusionment encompassing Europe after World War I. Wilson's refusal to compromise over the terms of the Treaty of Versailles kept the United States out of the League of Nations. As we will see in a few minutes, the lack of an American presence in the League and the world in general would open the door for German, Italian, and Japanese expansion throughout the 1930s. More on that in just a minute. The Red Scare would affect the way the United States dealt with Russia's rebranding itself as the Soviet Union. To call the United States isolationist might be a misuse of the word isolate, which the dictionary defines as cause to be or remain alone or apart from others. But the United States was still interacting with other countries through trade and economic agreements. It was also making agreements about military strength and American holdings in the world. The United States was trying to collect war debts through the Dawes Plan, when the Great Depression started, the Young Plan. The Fordney-McCumber Tariff and the Hawley-Smoot Tariff by the Republicans in the 1920s resulted in the United States interacting with Europeans, although not in the way the authors of those tariffs intended. All of this to avoid another war. But ultimately, the rise of fascism, totalitarianism, and Nazism, I'm not sure how important the precise label matters, would result in a second, deadlier world war. Before we get to Hitler, Tojo, and Mussolini, I do want to consider two events from the 1920s in a little more detail. Harding's Secretary of State was Charles Evans Hughes, who I spoke about as the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court during the early stages of the Roosevelt administration. If you're asking yourself, aren't we moving backwards along the historical timeline? Well, before I answer your question, I want to say that I am happy that you have put yourself in a position to be able to ask such a thing. But to answer your question, yes, but just for a few minutes. As I was saying, Harding's Secretary of State, Hughes, worked with Congress to pass legislation ending the war with Germany in 1921. Yes, World War I was officially over for the United States, 2 years after the war actually ended. Hughes then hosted the Washington Naval Conference in 1921, a meeting of all of the major naval powers, except Bolshevik Russia, which would be known as the Soviet Union the following year. At this meeting, he called for the major powers of the world to reduce the size of their navies. There would be a 10-year holiday on the construction of battleships. This shows the mindset of much of the world in the wake of World War I. Disarmament was seen as a means to prevent war in the future. There were 3 important treaties that came out of the conference. The most important agreement, the Five-Power Treaty, established limits for total naval tonnage and a ratio of armaments between the nations. You can see the amount for each of the countries in the chart there. In the agreement, the world's 2 biggest naval powers had the most, with Japan, France, and Italy having less. The arrangement, depicted in the political cartoon on the right, was not well received by Japan. To satisfy the Japanese, there were the 9 and 4-power treaties. Signatories of the 9-power treaty pledged to continue the open-door policy in China. The 4-power treaty between the United States, Great Britain, France, and Japan was designed to prevent tension over territorial possessions in the Pacific, basically calling for the status quo. The fact that Japan was part of this conversation tells us something about the rise of this once feudal nation from the country sharpening its scissors in one political cartoon I showed you in chapter 20, to the country knocking out the much bigger Russian in another political cartoon I showed you in chapter 20, to a country that was part of four and five power agreements in 1921, exacting concessions from the biggest powers on the planet that would attack the United States 20 years later. The Kellogg-Briand Pact was the brainchild of French Foreign Minister Aristide Briand and American Secretary of State, and the guy that replaced Charles Evans Hughes, Frank Kellogg. This agreement banned war. I know what you were thinking. Huh? Yes, the countries of the world attempted to outlaw war in 1928. Listen, I would love to outlaw sadness. Everyone is happy. No one is sad. Sounds great. That will not happen. Neither did an attempt to ban war. Defensive wars were still permitted. But it does show where the world's heads were at as the 1930s drew closer. Most countries, 62 would eventually sign the Kellogg-Briand Pact, did not want another war. Most, but not all. There were major changes to American foreign policy in Latin America during Franklin Roosevelt's time in office. American military actions in Latin America dramatically declined during the 1920s. President Hoover unofficially abandoned the policies of Theodore Roosevelt, Taft, and Wilson. Roosevelt's good neighbor policy would officially reject these policies. At the Inter-American Conference in 1933, Roosevelt's first Secretary of State, Cordell Hull, stated, "No state has the right to intervene in the internal or external affairs of another." This dramatically contradicted what Franklin's cousin thought about the role of the United States in this part of the world in his Roosevelt corollary. The Platt Amendment, that addition to the Cuban Constitution that the United States said had to be added or American forces would not leave Cuba after the Spanish-American War, was nullified. Roosevelt negotiated the end of a territorial dispute with Mexico rather than send in the military like Woodrow Wilson would have done. The United States was not leaving Latin America. They would still have economic influence there. American exports and imports to and from Latin America increased by 100% during the 1930s. While the United States tried to retreat from the world stage after World War I, the events of the 1930s would draw the United States back on stage by 1941. The events that would bring America out revolved around actions taken by totalitarian leaders who emerged and consolidated power during that period of disillusionment after World War I and the Great Depression. Joseph Stalin rose to power in the 1920s following the death of Vladimir Lenin. His forces attacked Poland from the east while Hitler attacked from the west when the war started in 1939. It was not until Hitler violated their agreement not to attack each other that Stalin became an ally of the United States. Adolf Hitler effectively used the German resentment towards the Treaty of Versailles and the failure of the Weimar Republic to help his Nazi party rise to power. By 1933, the same year FDR was sworn in as President of the United States, Adolf Hitler was appointed Chancellor. Historian Douglas Brinkley writes that Hitler was an Aryan racist, genocidal provocateur against Jews, Slavs, and countless others, was appointed Chancellor of Germany, and quickly consolidated power. Hitler's movement across Europe in defiance of the Treaty of Versailles would lead to the outbreak of the Second World War in Europe. Benito Mussolini, the leader of the Fascist Party, became Prime Minister of Italy in 1922 and loudly talked about a return to the days of the Roman Empire. Hirohito became the Emperor of Japan in 1926 and oversaw Japanese expansion in Asia during the 1930s. His selection of Hideki Tojo as Prime Minister in 1941 would culminate in the Japanese attacks on Pearl Harbor on December 7, 1941, and starting the war in the Pacific. Now let's talk about how we got to that day in December 1941. I'm going to cover a lot of ground quickly. Many of these events you covered in your world history classes last year. In 1931, Japan violated both the Nine Power Treaty and the Kellogg-Briand Pact, to which it was a signatory when it invaded Manchuria. The League of Nations sent observers and authored a report concluding that Manchuria should be returned to China. Japan responded by quitting the League and not returning Manchuria. Hoover's Secretary of State, Henry Stimson, responded by saying that the United States would not recognize any territories taken over by force. In 1933, President Roosevelt formally recognized the Soviet Union, the same year Adolf Hitler ascended to power in Germany. Inspired by a best-selling book, Merchants of Death, which blamed American arms manufacturers for World War I, Senator Gerald Nye, a staunch isolationist from North Dakota, held hearings in the United States Senate. The Nye Committee concluded that American involvement in the First World War was the result of bankers and corporations pressuring President Wilson. Nye was part of the majority of congressmen at the time that supported keeping the United States out of world affairs, particularly another European war. In 1935, Italy invaded Ethiopia and the League of Nations did nothing. The United States responded by passing the Neutrality Act of 1935, the first in a series of acts passed during the 1930s. The act said that the United States would not sell weapons to any country involved in a military conflict. Isolationists were seeking to prevent the use of protection of neutral rights as a reason for the United States to get into a war, as it had in 1812 and 1917. While in exile, the Emperor of Ethiopia, Haile Selassie, addressed the League of Nations and said that until the philosophy which holds one race superior and another inferior is finally and permanently discredited and abandoned, that until there are no longer first-class and second-class citizens of any nation, that until the color of a man's skin is of no more significance than the color of his eyes, that until the basic human rights are equally guaranteed to all without regard to race, that until that day, the dream of lasting peace and world citizenship and the rule of international morality will remain but a fleeting illusion to be pursued but never attained. The speech was famously turned into one of Bob Marley's best songs, War, which could be part of a playlist of songs describing the state of the world during the 1930s. In an attempt to render Germany incapable of offensive military action, the Treaty of Versailles prohibited Germany from having an army bigger than 100,000 men and having an air force. Hitler did not follow these articles of the treaty. In 1936, his forces marched into and remilitarized the Rhineland, which was an area in western Germany that borders France, Belgium, and Luxembourg. This, too, was a violation of the Treaty of Versailles, which tried to provide a buffer between Germany and Western Europe when it called for the occupation of this territory. The cartoon you see there sums up the response from the world. You see Hitler thumbing his nose at what the cartoonist calls the spineless leaders of democracy. In a reaction that will become common, the League of Nations did nothing. Appeasement, or allowing someone to do what they want so that they will stop, became the policy Europe adopted with regard to Hitler. When forces led by Francisco Franco challenged the government in 1936 in Spain, Hitler and Mussolini provided aid. The Spanish Civil War served as a training ground for Hitler's growing military. Some 3,000 Americans, known as the Abraham Lincoln Brigade, went to Spain to fight against Franco's fascist forces. America's best novelist, Ernest Hemingway, was there as a correspondent. His 1940 novel, For Whom the Bell Tolls, is set during the war. Congress passed the Neutrality Act of 1936, which renewed the 1935 Act and prohibited the United States to loan money or provide credit to nations involved in a war. As for the League of Nations, you guessed it, nothing. The Neutrality Act of 1937 created what was known as cash and carry, which meant that countries involved in a war could purchase non-military supplies from the United States as long as they paid cash and picked up the supplies themselves. There would not be American ships carrying supplies into a war zone like there had been during the Napoleonic Wars and the Great War. And in 1937, the American ship Panay was accidentally bombed and sunk by the Japanese in China. Japan apologized for what many believe was a deliberate attack on an American ship. The year 1937 also brought the Sino-Japanese War, where Japan launched a large assault on China. Japanese actions in Nanking, the capital of China at the time, showed the brutality with which the Japanese military could conduct itself. Journalist Iris Chang, in her book, The Rape of Nanking, wrote, "Tens of thousands of young men were rounded up and herded to the outer areas of the city, where they were mowed down by machine guns. used for bayonet practice, or soaked with gasoline and burned alive. For months, the streets of the city were heaped with corpses and reeked with the stench of rotting human flesh. As many as 350,000 Chinese were killed in this single city in a matter of weeks by Japanese forces. I will not waste your time with how the League of Nations responded. You already know. Roosevelt believed that the democracies of the world could not sit by and allow this to happen. He issued what is known as the Quarantine Speech. In it, he said, when an epidemic of physical disease starts to spread, the community approves and joins in a quarantine of the patients in order to protect the health of the community against the spread of the disease. It is my determination to pursue a policy of peace and to adopt every practicable measure to avoid involvement in war. It ought to be inconceivable that in this modern era and in the face of experience, any nation could not be so foolish and ruthless as to run the risk of plunging the whole world into war by invading and violating, in contravention of solemn treaties, the territory of other nations that have done them no real harm and are too weak to protect themselves adequately. Yet, the peace of the world and the welfare of the security of every nation are today being threatened by that very thing. The American public was not ready for this rhetoric in 1937. It would take a few more years and a few more attacks. The year 1938 saw Adolf Hitler continue to move in Europe in search of Lebensraum, which means living space. The word Anschluss in German means union. When we discuss the lead up to World War II, the word Anschluss is the unification of Austria and Germany. Hitler marched in, unopposed, and made Austria part of the German Reich in March 1938. There was little to no reaction to this from the rest of the world, who were willing to pay this cost to avoid another war. Later that year, Hitler laid claim to the Sudetenland in former Czechoslovakia. The Sudetenland was the area where people spoke German in former Czechoslovakia, which was created at the end of World War I. Britain and France began to realize that they should do something and agreed to meet with Hitler in Munich. The four-power pact, signed between Great Britain, France, Italy, and Germany, allowed Germany to keep the Sudetenland. In return, Hitler signed a peace treaty with Great Britain and promised he would not attempt to expand any further. In response to this appeasement, Chamberlain was criticized by Winston Churchill, who said, "You were given the choice between war and dishonor. You chose dishonor, and you shall have war." Chamberlain returned to Great Britain from Munich a hero, famously proclaiming, "I believe it is peace for our time." He was wrong. Churchill was right. You can see another political cartoon by Dr. Seuss there on the right. The Nazi snakes being told that they can only have one more lollipop by the appeasers. Before the invasion of Poland in 1939, which marked the start of World War II, Francisco Franco's fascist forces won the Spanish Civil War. Germany, breaking its agreement in Munich, took over the rest of former Czechoslovakia. Turns out they should not have taken Hitler at his word, a lesson the Soviet Union would soon learn. But before they would, they agreed to the Nazi-Soviet Non-Aggression Pact. This was not a military alliance. It was just a promise they would not attack each other. Then, on November 1, 1939, Poland was attacked by Germany from the west and the Soviet Union from the east. The German Blitzkrieg, or Lightning War, steamrolled Poland by air and ground. In response, Great Britain and France declared war on Germany, and the thing that the powers of the world had been trying to avoid for the last 20 years was now happening. The Great War had its sequel. In response to these events, the United States passed the Neutrality Act of 1939. The United States, while still neutral, clearly supported the Allies, the name given to those fighting Germany. Roosevelt wanted to provide weapons to the Allies by lifting the ban on the sale of weapons to countries involved in a war. Isolationist forces in Congress were still strong, but Roosevelt did get a second cash and carry policy through this final Neutrality Act. Like the first cash and carry policy in the Neutrality Act of 1937, nations had to pay cash and pick up goods. But this time, they could buy weapons. Events in Europe would cause Americans' opinion to change with regards to foreign policy. While the Soviet Union annexed Latvia, Lithuania, and Estonia and launched the Winter War against Finland, Hitler attacked and took over Denmark, Norway, the Netherlands, Belgium, and on June 22nd, France fell to the Nazi blitzkrieg. After a narrow escape from France at Dunkirk, Great Britain found itself confronting Hitler, now the master of Europe, alone. By July, two-thirds of Americans viewed Germany as a threat. There were different groups established to convince Americans that joining the war was both a good and a bad idea, and each provided their own propaganda. The Committee to Defend America by Aiding the Allies and the Fight for Freedom Committee were established to convince Americans that getting involved in the war by supporting the Allies was in the best interest of the United States. The posters there on the top present Germany as a threat. Fear, especially fear that one's children under threat, can be effective. The America First Committee, with prominent members such as Senator Gerald Nye, William Randolph Hearst, and Charles Lindbergh, attempted to mobilize public opinion against the war in what they viewed as Roosevelt's pro-Great Britain foreign policy. The America First Committee also attracted Nazi sympathizers and anti-Semites. Charles Lindbergh fell into this group. Also in 1940, the Axis powers were created with the signing of the Tripartite Pact. This was the alliance between Germany, Japan, and Italy. The year 1940 also included the first peacetime draft in American history, the Burke-Wadsworth Act. The German assault on Great Britain, one in which the British people endured an onslaught from the German Luftwaffe, their air force, for months with exceptional resolve. While more than 15,000 British died in the Battle of Britain, it marked the first defeat for Adolf Hitler. In response, the United States passed the Destroyers for Bases deal, which gave the British military supplies and ships in exchange for military bases in the Caribbean and Bermuda. And finally, in 1940, President Roosevelt was elected to an unprecedented third term in office when he defeated Wendell Willkie by a wide margin. Dr. Seuss drew hundreds of cartoons during the war. These images were critical of not only the Axis powers, but also of American non-intervention foreign policy during this time period. This image establishes the United States as trying to fight a gentleman's war while the Japanese and Germans play dirty. Notice the BRICS, Pearl Harbor, and Manila. We'll get to those in just a minute. This one shows the Japanese along the West Coast lining up to receive explosive. The words fifth column mean a group within a country working with the enemy. This image plays to the false idea that those of Japanese ancestry were spies working for Japan and America. There are a lot of cartoons that reference the America First Committee. Here, a woman is reading Adolf the Wolf to little children. This one has a poem entitled The Isolationist that reads, "Said a whale, there is so much commotion, such fights among fish in the ocean. I'm saving my scalp, living high on an alp. Dear Lindy, he gave me the notion." Lindy is a reference to Charles Lindbergh. Seuss was not one of those Americans who thought the United States should not be involved in the affairs of Europe. Here, Americans are putting on hats that allows them to bury their heads in the sand and ignore the events that were going on. This last one shows Americans trying to get aid to the British, and it does not seem to be going well. For me, the remarkable thing about these cartoons is that they are drawn by Dr. Seuss. Any of these characters could be part of a Dr. Seuss story that most people have read, except for those images drawn using stereotypes and the Nazi woodpecker. I cannot finish a discussion of Dr. Seuss without letting you know what the three best Dr. Seuss books are. This list is not up for debate. I am a teacher. Let me teach. Number three is Fox and Socks. This book is frustratingly brilliant. Number two is Green Eggs and Ham. This book is brilliantly simple. Dr. Seuss only used 50 words in this book to win a bet with his publisher. And the number one Dr. Seuss book is One Fish, Two Fish, Red Fish, Blue Fish. This book is brilliantly superior. Everything about this book is perfect. With re-election behind him, FDR sought to extend more aid to Great Britain, which was on the verge of bankruptcy and lacked the cash needed under the cash and carry policy. In December 1940, Roosevelt went on the radio and coined the phrase "arsenal of democracy." He said, "We must be the great arsenal of democracy. For us, this is an emergency as serious as war itself. We must apply ourselves to our task with the same resolution, the same sense of urgency, the same spirit of patriotism and sacrifice as we would show were we at war. His solution was the Lend-Lease Act. This allowed the president to lend arms to any country the president deems vital to the defense of the United States. That country was Great Britain. All that Great Britain had to do was promise to return these weapons after the war. The act was passed with broad support in Congress. The isolationists were no longer winning the argument. Frustrated by his inability to defeat Britain, Hitler turned his attention to the Soviet Union. In 1941, he launched Operation Barbarossa, an attack on the Soviet Union in violation of the pact he had signed just 2 years earlier. The United States responded by forming an alliance with the communist government of the Soviet Union and offering them aid through the Lend-Lease Act. The saying, "The enemy of my enemy is my friend," comes to mind here. The United States was now supplying war materials to enemies on both sides of Adolf Hitler, who now found himself fighting a two-front war. In April, Roosevelt and Winston Churchill, who became the Prime Minister of Great Britain a year earlier, met in secret to discuss a strategy to follow if the United States were to enter the war. Churchill's goal was to convince Roosevelt to declare war. This would not happen here, but the two agreed to common principles that would lead to what they called a better future for the world. This was known as the Atlantic Charter, and it laid out what the world should look like after the final destruction of Nazi tyranny. While everyone seemed to be distracted, Japan was moving in Asia. In July 1941, they seized Indochina, a French colony. Roosevelt responded by freezing all Japanese assets in the United States and establishing an embargo on all trade. This severely hurt Japan, who needed this trade to keep its war machine moving, which is hard to do without oil. Initially, it seemed like there would be a compromise, but in October, General Hideki Tojo, the leader of Japan's war party, was installed as prime minister. Tojo did not share his successor's desire to negotiate with the United States, especially when it came to Japan's occupation of China. The United States knew as early as November 29th that an attack was imminent, but they had no idea where. I will let President Roosevelt take it from here.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy, the United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan. The United States was at peace with that nation, and at the solicitation of Japan, was still in conversation with its government and its emperor, looking toward the maintenance of peace in the Pacific. Indeed, 1 hour after Japanese air squadrons had commenced bombing in the American island of Oahu, the Japanese ambassador to the United States and his colleague delivered to our Secretary of State a formal reply to a recent American message. And while this reply stated that it seemed useless to continue the existing diplomatic negotiations, it contained no threat or hint of war or of armed attack. It will be recorded that the distance of Hawaii from Japan makes it obvious that the attack was deliberately planned many days or even weeks ago. During the intervening time, the Japanese government has deliberately sought to deceive the United States by false statements and expressions of hope for continued peace. The attack yesterday on the Hawaiian Islands has caused severe damage to American naval and military forces. I regret to tell you that very many American lives have been lost. In addition, American ships have been reported torpedoed on the high seas between San Francisco and Honolulu. Yesterday, the Japanese government also launched an attack against Malaya. Last night, Japanese forces attacked Hong Kong. Last night, Japanese forces attacked Guam. Last night, Japanese forces attacked the Philippine Islands. Last night, the Japanese attacked Wake Island. And this morning, the Japanese attacked Midway Island. Japan has therefore undertaken a surprise offensive extending throughout the Pacific area. The facts of yesterday and today speak for themselves. The people of the United States have already formed their opinions and well understand the implications to the very life and safety of our nation. As Commander-in-Chief of the Army and Navy, I have directed that all measures be taken for our defense. But always will our whole nation remember the character of the onslaught against us.
At Pearl Harbor, the Japanese launched 350 planes from aircraft carriers and sank 8 battleships, 3 cruisers, 4 other vessels, destroyed nearly 200 planes, and killed more than 2,400 people. Only 64 Japanese were killed in the attack. The United States Congress voted 388-1 to declare war on Japan. Representative Jeanette Rankin of Montana, who had also voted against going to war in 1917, was the lone dissenting vote. It is worth noting that Representative Rankin was the first woman to hold federal office in the United States when she was elected to Congress in 1916. Hitler declared war 5 days later, which was an interesting decision and probably a mistake. It is not clear if Roosevelt would have been able to convince the Congress to declare war on Germany as well as Japan. Hitler made this easy for FDR. As Roosevelt said in his address, Japan did not only attack the United States, they attacked locations throughout the Pacific, including Wake Island, Hong Kong, Singapore, Burma, and both of the American Pacific colonies, Guam and Puerto Rico. They had their sights set on Australia and Hawaii as well. The objective for Japan was to convince the United States that fighting in the Pacific was not worth the cost. Japan took over the Philippines and captured an army of 80,000 American and Filipino soldiers, which was the largest force surrendered in American history. The early stages of the war were not going well. The tide began to turn in May 1942 at the Battle of Coral Sea, when American forces were able to stop the Japanese from controlling the Coral Sea, which borders the northeast coast of Australia. Then in June, the United States scored a major victory at the Battle of Midway, which was a small American refueling station between Hawaii and Asia. The miracle at Midway, as it was dubbed, resulted in the destruction of 4 Japanese aircraft carriers. The United States only lost 1 and now possessed the momentum in the fight against Japan. The Russians were calling for its allies to open up a second front in Europe to take pressure off of the Soviet Union, who was trying to hold off Nazi forces. They supported the idea of an invasion across the English Channel into France. Instead, the United States and Great Britain launched an attack on Erwin Rommel's forces in North Africa in October 1942. The Germans were looking to control the Suez Canal. The Allies pushed German forces out of Egypt at the Battle of El Alamein. They then launched an assault known as Operation Torch, led by General Dwight Eisenhower, against Axis forces in Morocco, Algeria, and Tunisia. By May 1943, Germany was driven out of Africa. This delay did not make the Soviet Union happy, but the Soviets were in an improved position after the Battle of Stalingrad. Now, improved improved position depends on the metric one uses to assess the Soviet Union after this six-month battle. More than 1 million Soviets died in the battle, and the city was destroyed. But Hitler was defeated and had to use a lot of resources and manpower. He had lost the offensive. At the start of World War II, there were around 127,000 people of Japanese ancestry living in the United States. About a third were Issei, unnaturalized first generation, and the remainder were Nisei, naturalized or native-born citizens. Following the attack on Pearl Harbor, these individuals were viewed as threats. There were stories about how they were spies working for Japan, or they were helping prepare for an invasion of the West Coast. There was no evidence that any of this happened. Executive Order 9066 gave the president the authority to relocate the Japanese to what the government called relocation camps. Others might call them prison camps. The War Relocation Authority was in charge of the movement of 112,000 people to these camps. Almost 80,000 were American citizens. They were told to bring what they could carry, and they were rounded up and taken. One of the most remarkable things about this was how there was not as much protest from these individuals as you might think. Many of them just did what the government asked them to do. This was not the case for all of those of Japanese ancestry. Gordon Hirabayashi and Fred Korematsu resisted and had their cases heard at the Supreme Court. In Korematsu v. U.S., the Supreme Court said that this was constitutional in 1944, arguing that the internment of the Japanese was a military necessity. Justice Owen Roberts wrote in a dissenting opinion, "This is not a case of keeping people off the streets at night. It is the case of convicting a citizen as a punishment for not submitting to imprisonment in a concentration camp, solely because of his ancestry, without evidence or inquiry concerning his loyalty. Most would not be able to return to their homes on the West Coast until 1945. President Reagan apologized on behalf of the government in 1985, and some received financial payments in 1988 for their losses." Like with World War I, there was propaganda. You can see the godless Nazis stabbing a knife through the Bible, and the children threatened by the swastika. The popularity of film made it necessary to make sure the industry was censored during World War II. There were a lot of patriotic films that came out in the 1940s. Anything German, Japanese, or Italian was demonized. The American economy was also similar to World War I, as the United States moved into wartime production. The rationing of items that could be used by the troops was implemented. You can see Mickey and his friends doing their part there. Americans could only buy certain amounts of meat, butter, tires, canned goods, shoes, sugar, coffee, and gas. You can see the poster there where the man is driving, with Hitler as his co-pilot. There are a couple of video links here that I would show you in class. These propaganda cartoons involving characters you are familiar with are worth your time. I will put the links for these videos in the description on the YouTube. The Three Little Pigs video from Canada will ruin that story for you. Production during World War II ended the Great Depression. The war economy produced 300,000 military planes, 86,000 tanks, 3 million machine guns, and 71,000 naval ships. As I had said at the end of the Chapter 25 video, unemployment was 17% when World War II started in Europe. It was 10% when the United States entered the war, and it was 2% when the war ended in 1945. The government worked with business through the War Production Board to make sure that the American military was able to get the tanks, airplanes, uniforms, and equipment it needed. The Office of Price Administration froze agricultural prices, wages, salaries, and rents to combat inflation. To pay for the war, the government collected war bonds like it did during World War I. It also raised taxes. The Revenue Act of 1942 included a 5% victory tax on all incomes over $624, and there was a 90% tax on excess profits. The use of family in propaganda is an effective tool. Here, you see the children threatened, and the only way to keep them safe? Buy war bonds. If you want your husband, son, or grandson to come home soon, you guessed it, buy war bonds. Industry lost a lot of men to the war, so women and minorities were able to step in, fill these roles, and play a major role in winning the war, in spite of their being treated as second-class citizens. African Americans endured Jim Crow and came north to find work in defense plants. Many encountered angry whites who did not want African Americans in their communities. One example was in Detroit, where black families were greeted with signs reading, "We want white tenants in our white communities." Race riots there led to the death of 34 people in Detroit, Michigan, not Mississippi. When A. Philip Randolph, the leader of the Brotherhood of Sleeping Car Porters, threatened to march on Washington in 1941 using the slogan, "We loyal Negro American citizens demand our right to work and fight for our country," Eleanor Roosevelt met with him and tried to encourage him to not embarrass the president during this time. When he met with FDR, the president said, "You know, Mr. Randolph, that if you bring 100,000 blacks into Washington, there's absolutely no place for them to eat. Furthermore, there's no place for them to sleep. And even more serious, there's no place in Washington where they can use toilet facilities." Randolph responded to the president saying, "This is not my fault nor my problem, but you can issue an executive order before we get here, opening up the toilets, opening up the restaurants, and making it possible for us to sleep in hotels." Roosevelt's response? Executive Order 8802, which prohibited racial discrimination in defense industries. Also, he created the Fair Employment Practices Commission to investigate discrimination in defense industries. Randolph, realizing this was probably the best he was going to get from the president, called off the march. It's important to remember that this is America in 1941. The same country where Congressman Martin Dies of Texas claimed that communists were trying to convince African Americans that they should be equal to whites, and the FBI, under the leadership of J. Edgar Hoover, concluded that it was the Axis powers who were trying to create racial tension in America. I am not sure that Black America in the 1940s needed the help of communists or members of the Axis to understand where they stood in American society. For African Americans, the war was about victory abroad as well as victory at home. The Bracero program allowed for many Mexican workers to enter the United States. Many Mexicans were deported during the Great Depression, but the war created opportunities that needed to be filled quickly, even in factories. Mexicans constituted the second largest group of people moving into American cities during the war, second only to African Americans. This caused tension in American cities as a result of white resentment. One example was the Zoot Suit Riots in Los Angeles. During World War II, the number of women working increased by 60%. Women constituted one-third of paid workers in 1945, up from 25% in 1940. Women worked in defense industry jobs that typically went to men. This is another similarity with the First World War. There were also 200,000 women who served in the military as nurses, ambulance drivers, radio operators, and pilots. World War II served as a natural continuation of the development of women's rights we have seen during the 20th century, which corresponds with women becoming more visible in society. The symbol for this during World War II was Rosie the Riveter. Women were proving that they could do it. African Americans served in segregated units with white officers. At the beginning of the war, black soldiers were limited to menial tasks like loading ships, driving trucks, digging latrines, and handling supplies and mail, and were prohibited from joining the Marines and the Army Air Force. As a result of protests and the need for manpower, African Americans would be allowed to serve in combat. Some training camps were partially integrated, and black sailors served on ships with white sailors. The most well-known example of African Americans in combat during the war was the Tuskegee Airmen, who flew more than 15,000 missions during the war and played a key role in the 1943 Allied campaign in Sicily that we will get to in a few minutes. More than 30,000 Japanese Americans served in the military during the war. These Nisei regiments were among the most highly decorated in the Army during World War II. Many of these soldiers went off to fight the war while their families were imprisoned in camps back in the United States. The Chinese Exclusion Act was repealed in 1943, allowing for a small number of immigrants to enter annually from China and for those awaiting naturalization to become citizens. There was a higher proportion of Chinese Americans drafted than any other national group. Native Americans played a key role in the war effort in the military, in defense industries, and as code talkers. They served in units with white soldiers. The use of Native American languages, which could not be broken by the Japanese and Germans, gave the United States an advantage over their adversaries. 300,000 Mexican Americans served in the military in non-segregated units as well. After the victory at the Battle of Midway, the United States assumed the offensive in the war in the Pacific. The Battle of Guadalcanal was the Japanese Army's first defeat of the war. American forces led by General Douglas MacArthur won a brutal fight with Japan, who had 20,000 men die as a result of the battle. An American soldier said of this battle, I had never heard or read of this kind of fighting. These people refused to surrender. The Japanese viewed surrender as cowardly. Any account of the war in the Pacific clearly shows the ferocity with which the Japanese fought the war. I would recommend Eugene Sledge's memoir, With the Old Breed. The victory at Guadalcanal allowed American forces under command of General MacArthur and Admiral Chester Nimitz to start their move toward the Philippines and eventually Japan. This strategy was known as island hopping. It involved attacking major islands and leaving smaller ones cut off before eventually reaching the Japanese mainland. In October 1944, the United States and Japan engaged in a series of battles in the Philippine Sea known as the Battle of Leyte Gulf. This was the largest naval battle in history and one that severely damaged the Japanese war effort, as they lost more than 12,000 men, 4 carriers, 3 battleships, 10 cruisers, and 11 destroyers. There were 4,000 kamikaze suicide missions in this battle alone. Upon leading an army of 80,000 men in the Philippines to surrender in 1942, General MacArthur had promised that he would return. Following the Battle of Leyte Gulf, MacArthur came ashore to keep his word. The Battle of Manila involved some of the most ferocious urban fighting of the war. To reacquire the Philippines, there were 80,000 U.S. and over 400,000 Japanese casualties. The Japanese slaughtered Filipino civilians. The number of civilian deaths is estimated between 100 and 240,000. Manila was liberated in early March 1945, but the Japanese did not stop fighting until a month after the emperor had surrendered in August. As the United States got closer to Japan, the fighting intensified. At Iwo Jima, the United States claimed this tiny volcanic island at high cost, with nearly 7,000 Marines dying and more than 17,000 Japanese deaths out of a troop force of around 21,000. The battle is, of course, memorialized in Arlington National Cemetery. The monument is based on the famous photograph taken atop Mount Suribachi. The iconic image was actually of the second flag that was raised after the first one was deemed too small. The final major battle before the United States would reach Japan was fought at Okinawa. Remember when I said that the fighting intensified as the United States got closer to Japan? Well, the fighting at Okinawa proves me right. The island is less than 400 miles from Japan. In taking the island, the United States suffered more than 50,000 casualties, with around 100,000 Japanese deaths in this final battle. When the Battle of Okinawa started, Franklin Roosevelt was the commander-in-chief of the United States. But by the time it ended, Harry Truman was the commander-in-chief, and one of the first decisions he would have to make would be about what to do next. As vice president, Harry Truman did not know about the Manhattan Project. Before we get to that, let's go back to Europe and catch up. So we are going back in time. Remember that the events described here are going on at the same time as the events I just went through in the Pacific. In January 1943, Roosevelt and Churchill met at Casablanca, Morocco, where they agreed on an invasion of Sicily. Churchill hoped that this would knock Italy out of the war and force Hitler to commit troops there, potentially moving some from France. The two allies also agreed that the war would only end with the unconditional surrender of Germany. American and British forces landed in Sicily on July 9, 1943, and in a little over 5 weeks, they had conquered the island and were moving towards the Italian mainland. Mussolini was forced to Germany when his government collapsed, and Germany was forced to move forces to Italy. By June 1944, the Allies had captured Rome. The campaign in Italy highlighted the diverse fighting force the United States used in the war, with the Nisei regiments and Tuskegee Airmen helping to secure victory over the Axis. The first meeting of the Big Three took place at Tehran, Iran, in the winter of 1943. The Big Three refers to the Allies. At Tehran, Roosevelt and Churchill agreed to launch an assault into France and start the liberation of Western Europe. The Soviet Union was now on the offensive against Hitler and agreed to enter the war in the Pacific once the war in Europe came to an end. The plan to invade France across the English Channel at Normandy and push the Germans back was known as Operation Overlord. There were five beaches where American, British, and Canadian troops would land. The operation was led by Dwight Eisenhower. June 6, 1944 was D-Day. The invasion, which was the largest amphibious assault in world history, involved a million men along a 50-mile stretch of beach along the coast of Normandy. Paratroopers from the 101st and 82nd Airborne dropped in shortly after midnight behind German lines. If you have seen or read Band of Brothers, this would be them. The 4,000 vessels that landed troops and supplies on the beaches encountered heavy resistance from the Germans, but ultimately the United States would take the beaches and start the liberation of Western Europe. By September 1944, France, Luxembourg, and Belgium had been freed, and Hitler found his forces moving back towards Berlin. For spring break in 2009, my wife and I went to Normandy. As you know, I like to provide evidence that I have actually been to these places, so there I am. They had some equipment from the battle laying around. There was Pointe du Hoc, which is a 100-foot cliff on the northwest coast of Normandy. It was here on D-Day that 225 Army Rangers landed, scaled that cliff, and attacked German positions there. These men held out for 2 days until they were relieved. Only 90 survived. There is my wife and a bomb crater. If you look at the landscape, you can see where bombs were dropped. When you go to the beach, you see a lot of these. They are called Czech hedgehogs. They were put along the beach by the Germans to prevent Allied vehicles from getting onto the beach. And then there's the beach, and it's just that, a beach. But the minute you walk onto the beach and look around, you can recreate Hitler's Atlantic Wall in your mind and see the invasion. It is overwhelming. As my wife and I walked along Omaha Beach, I looked up and saw this. It piqued my interest, so we climbed up. And I got in. Of course I did. It is a German pillbox. There would have been two men inside, one shooting and the other keeping the weapon loaded so that it could repeatedly fire at American forces. And this would have been the perspective of those two German soldiers on D-Day. This cemetery continues for a long way in both directions and is quite the testament honoring those Americans who gave their life for the liberation of Western Europe. If you ever in your life have the opportunity to go to Normandy, I highly recommend it. Hitler launched his final offensive into Belgium at Ardennes in the winter of 1944. This costly attack resulted in almost 100,000 casualties for both Hitler and the Allies. The loss of manpower and equipment forced Hitler's army to retreat back towards Berlin. In an 18-day period in April 1945, three world leaders died as the war in Europe would come to an end. Franklin Roosevelt died in Warm Springs, Georgia on April 12th. His vice president, Harry Truman, said at the time, "There have been very few men in all history that equal the man into whose shoes I am stepping." On April 28th, Benito Mussolini was captured, shot, his body thrown in the street, and urinated on and stoned. He was then hung by his feet, and his body was buried in an unmarked grave. And 2 days later, on April 30th, 5 days after American and Soviet forces had met at the Elbe River in Germany, Adolf Hitler committed suicide in a bunker in Berlin. On May 8th, Germany surrendered. The war in Europe was over. The United States now could focus on the war in the Pacific. There was a race during World War II between the United States and Germany to harness the power of uranium to create an atomic bomb. The U.S. government would secretly spend $2 billion to research and develop the weapon in labs around the United States. It was known as the Manhattan Project. Harry Truman did not find out about this until he was sworn in as president. Under the leadership of J. Robert Oppenheimer, scientists constructed this bomb in Los Alamos, New Mexico. The first test, known as the Trinity Test, was on July 16, 1945. The next day, Truman met with the Allies at Potsdam in Germany. The Big Three looked different at Potsdam. Truman now represented the United States, and Great Britain was represented by both Churchill and Clement Attlee. The two men were in the final stages of a campaign for prime minister, so Churchill thought it was important to allow Attlee to attend. During the conference, it was announced that Attlee had won the election. The conference highlighted issues that would come up between the Allies during the Cold War, as Stalin was not on the same page as the leaders of the United States and Great Britain. But we will get to those issues in Chapter 27. The Allies issued the Potsdam Declaration, which told Japan that it should surrender or face prompt and utter destruction. There was debate in the United States over whether it should use its new weapon. Truman was warned that it would take 250,000 American lives to take the island of Japan. These estimates actually varied depending on the source. Some said 60,000, and others as many as 500,000. There were also those who said the bomb should not be used, including some scientists who actually worked on the Manhattan Project. One of these was Leo Szilard, who had 70 scientists sign a petition that said the United States should let Japan know how deadly the weapon was and then allow them to surrender. He wrote to Truman, "A nation which lets the precedent of using these newly liberated forces of nature for purposes of destruction may have to bear responsibility of opening the door to an era of devastation on an unimaginable scale." On his desk in the Oval Office, Truman kept a sign that read, "The buck stops here," and it would on this decision. He would later say, "As President of the United States, I had the fateful responsibility of deciding whether or not to use this weapon for the first time. It was the hardest decision I ever had to make. But presidents cannot duck from hard problems. He cannot pass the buck. I made the responsibility after decisions with the ablest men in our government, and after long and prayerful consideration, I decided that the bomb should be used in order to end the war quickly and save countless lives, Japanese as well as American." When the Japanese did not surrender, they were shown what the Allies meant by prompt and utter destruction. The first atomic bomb was dropped from the Enola Gay, named after its pilot Paul Tibbetts' mother, on Hiroshima on August 6, 1945. Its distinct mushroom cloud ushered in the nuclear age and would change the way many nations armed and defended themselves from this point forward. 70% of the city was destroyed, killing approximately 80,000 civilians. The Soviet Union declared war on Japan on August 8th. The only word that comes to mind is destruction. The bomb would also affect future generations, as the effects of the radioactive fallout would lead to birth defects. It is difficult to calculate precisely how devastating the impact was beyond the images you see here. Here's a section of Hiroshima before the bomb, and here it is after the bomb. Like I said, destruction. When the Japanese refused to surrender, a second bomb was dropped on August 9th, this one on Nagasaki. These cities were chosen not for their military values, but for the fact that they were relatively untouched by the war. This would allow for the United States to better see the damage of their new weapon. This second atomic bomb killed 100,000 civilians. Here's a part of Hiroshima before the bomb on the left and after on the right. Even after this, the Japanese War Council was divided. It took the intervention of the emperor to end the war. On September 2nd, 1945, Japanese officials signed the Articles of Surrender aboard the Missouri. World War II was officially over. Let's close the show by quickly considering the impact of the Second World War. 15 million soldiers died fighting in World War II, with approximately 60 million civilians also perishing as a result of the fighting around the world. For America, the nearly 400,000 deaths made World War II the second deadliest war in the nation's history, trailing only the Civil War. The Great Depression was over, and the United States would enter into a period that looked very similar to the 1920s. We will discuss that in Chapter 28. On the world stage, there were now two superpowers, the United States and the Soviet Union. In the Cold War, a country was either with us or them, and isolation was no longer on the table. Next time, we will look at the Truman administration in the early Cold War. Lee and Luke, say goodbye to these fine people.
Goodbye.
Goodbye.
I let Lee and Luke pick the pictures on the last slide. It is supposed to be random, and I intentionally do not explain them. But this one I feel like warrants an explanation. Leah, tell these fine people who that is and why you picked that picture.
That's Helen Keller, and I picked her because she did so many cool things when she was deaf and blind.
Good night, Albuquerque.